All right, guys, Brian here with VetteSource coming back with you today, where we're going to take a closer look at another one of our subsystems here on the C4 Corvettes that I've kind of been doing. I wouldn't call it a series, but I've been getting focused on these, where we've talked about the CD player, FX3, other systems, ASR here. And what we're going to do is kind of focus on the other system here, our climate control system on these Corvettes. Now, interesting thing about the climate control in the Corvettes is that obviously if you've got a later C3, I was just turning off the delayed accessory bus there. That'll be another thing I can talk about later. But anyway, the climate control system on these Corvettes went through quite a bit of evolution. And of course, everybody's just used to seeing, of course, electronic AC on these, which this electronic air conditioning, if we go all the way back into our historical archives, electronic air conditioning was not actually even introduced into automobiles until the year 1964. And of course, once again, Cadillac was the first one that had introduced the electronic climate control system. I think they called it Comfort Climate or Climate Comfort, I believe was the name of the system. And of course, the next year, the year after, Oldsmobile and Buick, I think Buick had it too. They called it, Oldsmobile called it Comfortron. And it was a very, even back then, a complicated system that was all analog. There was nothing actually electronic on it. Even the dial wheels and everything were still looked like a manual control, but it actually controlled the temperature setting in the car. Now, over the years, 40, 50 years, 60 years, this has been in place. They've gotten a lot better with it, obviously. It's become a much more interesting system. And in fact, one of the early problems they had was they had to solve the issue of how to blend the heat and the cool air together and then re-separate it again, obviously, to separate out the humidity and other things that would make it more difficult for them to control it. But what they did was they figured out a way to run all the incoming air across the evaporator and then split it back up after that, run one side across the heater core with a blend actuator door. That's what it's called. So, interestingly enough, the Corvettes did not receive... Corvettes received air conditioning for the first time in 1963. However, they did not get electronic air conditioning until all the way into 1986. In fact, the first 2 years of a C4, you could not get electronic air conditioning. It was all just manual AC controls. And all the way through 1996, Corvettes, the C4s, you could have manual air conditioning. Actually, even into the C5s, there are manual AC controls in the C5s. I don't remember which year specifically they got rid of it, but I want to say it was midway through the C5s. I may be wrong. I just haven't looked at the C5 side because so many of them are electronic climate controls and every one of them has problems. But anyway, this is the second generation of the climate control, electronic climate control for the C4s. The first generation was a little bit more basic. You had one little blue LCD readout there. Of course, it's raining while I'm doing this. This is why I'm in the car, guys. And a couple of buttons that would get sticky and have problems. But anyway, it was the first generation of the series. This would be the second generation of the series, and this ran from 1990 through 1996. Now, rather than try to cram every bit of component and circuit operation in here in one video, I'm just going to talk about the control of the actuation of the control head itself, because even controlling this is kind of a complex type of operation. A lot of people don't understand how it works. But I will identify there's three basic sensors that make this system work right here. There is the incoming air temperature sensor, which is way out there on the front frame rail. There is an inside air temperature sensor right there. And there is a sun load sensor right there. You can see that little round knob there, which obviously is telling us how much of a sun load we're getting inside the car. Now, of course, in the inner compartment on the Corvette is smaller, so it's much more susceptible to radical changes in heat and or cold. So the other thing too about this is interesting is this was offered, the electronic air conditioning was offered as a standalone option all the way up until 1993. And then for some reason, they packaged it, they bundled it with the 1SB package, which they were not separated out. So you couldn't go in and say, hey, I want just a Bose cassette, no CD player, but I want electronic air conditioning. The 1SB package included the upgrade to the Delco Bose Gold, at least the cassette, not the CD player, and the electronic air conditioning. Standalone, this was around $250, which really is not that much, but it added a layer of more complex components that, again, I'll talk about in another video to show you how to do correct operations. So, you know, most people will get in here. Let's go ahead and we'll turn our car on just so we can watch what we're doing here. And of course, on mine, you can see the our Aqua LT4 here. The LCD light is burned out on the backside. You can see that it's darker. It should be more of an orange like this. Now, another thing too, this second generation controller, there are three different versions of the faceplate on this controller. 90 through 91 has a gray backing with orange lettering. 92-93 has a black backing with orange lettering. 94 through 96 has a black backing with white lettering. That turns orange when you turn the lights on. Let's see if it'll do it for us, if you can see. There you go. So it's an interesting little trick that they did there, making that work. So anyway, obviously you've got 13 buttons on this. I got a little coolant right now, so we need to watch our temperature as we are. So you basically going across, you've got your off, right? Your auto, your recirculation, your blend, where you want the airflow to go, and that would be on your chest and on your legs. And of course, or just on your chest or on your legs. This is actually the heater button. It does not say heater, but this is specifically how you turn the heater on. You can also run these blend doors a different way, but this would be your default setting if you wanted the heater. And of course, this is your windshield defroster, and this is your back window defogger, okay? Coming up here, this will be to set your climate control, the setting you want, your readout of your outside air temperature, and then of course your fan speed can either go auto or up and down fan speed. That's why you have two auto buttons on this display. This is one thing that confuses a lot of people. So if I go in here, let's just say I want to put this thing on auto mode, I don't want to have to think about it. I'm just going to basically select my auto button, okay? And you'll see how that auto lit up right there. And what it's doing now is it's thinking about it. Now it's giving me airflow, okay? And I don't have any Freon in this car at the moment, simply because it's got a Freon leak that we've got to address. But you can see here now, if I go back here, right, and I want to go ahead and adjust my fan speed on the auto side, this would be temperature set. This is the way you do this, is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to set this all the way back. Now you see by numbers, it'll go back to 65 on its own, right? Now if I want to go ahead and slow this down, you can hear the fan is running faster right now. If I want to slow this down, I'm simply going to turn this back up to where I get to 85, okay? Now, the other thing this will not do is if it's cold outside and the engine coolant hasn't reached temperature yet, it will actually wait before it runs the fan until the coolant warms up to, I believe it's above 32 degrees Celsius. I don't remember which one that is. But anyway, you can see here how this works. Now, there's an interesting thing here. You see how I just went jumped from 85 to 90? That's our upper limit. It jumped 5 degrees right there, right? And it will do the same thing. See, if I'm around 75, it won't run the fan at all, simply because that's about the temperature we're at right now. And I am second week of January, we're at 75 degrees outside, which is fun. So if I go back here, right, and I go to 65, this is my max auto setting. But if I go back to 60, where it jumps from 65 to 60, what that does is it locks out the auto function. Even though the auto is still showing, this has locked out my auto function, and it's basically not doing anything other than just running full speed. It's not actually trying to keep it at 60, it's just running at full speed as if you were gonna do manual. Now, if I wanted to go ahead and take this back to 65, but let's say that I don't want the fan to be running as fast as I need it to this, what I can do here is I can take this down arrow here, and I can start, and see how my auto came off there? So that means my auto fan is off. I'm commanding the fan on its own. And see how what it'll do is it will actually turn that back. I can go all the way back to 1. Now, if I go, even though I'm still on auto and my temp setting is still at 65, my fan is not blowing. Now, to get that back activated again, all I've got to do is hit that button again. And there it goes, okay? And then you'll see once it starts back up again, I'm back at 10 fan speed, right? Now, I can also go ahead and set this back up to 75. And then if I look at My fan speed's only on 4, see that? So it's an interesting, again, this feature is meant to keep this in the temperature setting you choose between 65 to 85 degrees, which is only about a 20 degree spread. 85 to 90 and 60 to 65 are just straight up. What it's going to do is it's going to blow as hard as it can all the time just to keep you going. Now, of course, moving over, we're in auto mode. This obviously, this little arrow inside of here, which looks a lot like a refresh button on an internet connection, this is our recirculation, okay? So the setting, the maximum cooling on this one is going to be, because what it's doing is it's not drawing outside air in from the outside. It's simply recirculating the air that's already inside the car that may be cooled down, and it's going to keep blowing that out again. Now, of course, obviously, you move over to here, we've got a setting where we're going to blow it out of the face vents, which you'll notice what it does, it actually comes down just a little bit, and then also blows vents out of the vents here, right there. Okay, and it becomes smaller. Even though I'm still in auto mode on the fan, right, it's actually blowing it, diverting it to both directions. And of course, if I just want it to come out straight here, right, it will actually go out. And of course, this mode, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention, this is called bi-level mode, okay? Now, this is what's known as the vent. Of course, it does not say it again like it does in the older AC systems, but if you choose this button here, you notice how my auto turned off right here, right? Of course, my auto turns off any one of these I select, right? If I go back to here, and then I pick recirc, my auto turns off. If I turn this, auto turns off. But if I click this button, this is just the vent, so it actually turns the compressor off on the car. It will not run in this setting. It'll adjust to the temperature setting selected, but it won't cool the vehicle interior colder than the outside temperature, okay? So this is just if you want the fan going, and then what you can do is you can go ahead and just run this up and have just straight vent if that's what you want to do, okay? Other thing too is, again, like I mentioned, this is the heater one. So if you hit this heater button, then what that's going to do is it directs all the airflow down to the bottom, and then I can go ahead and go back to my temperature setting and go to 85, and I'll get hot air out of the bottom vents. And of course, because heat rises, that's why they use the heater there. Now, if I wanted to override that, I could just go to bi-level, right? And bi-level is just going to blow hot air at my face and as well as my legs if that's what I wanted to warm up a little bit. So these essentially could be considered part of the heater function, and of course control with your temperature and your fan speed, how much or how little you want. But for now, we're going to go back to auto, and we're going to go back to 65. Now, the other interesting thing about these is that the convertibles and the coupes both have a different button over here in the corner. Since the convertibles don't have a, excuse me, what am I trying to say? They don't have the, goodness gracious, for the rear window control, even though it's weird, as I'm sitting here thinking about it, I know that the rear windows on a convertible have a defrost setting, but anyway, regardless, a convertible is going to have a mirror button here. In fact, you can see it right there. See how that says a mirror? And then, of course, on a coupe, it's going to be for the windshield or for the rear window. So I'm not sure, again, I'm going to have to read a little bit more on that. I'm sitting here as I'm talking about it. It doesn't make sense to me in my mind. But anyway, so all that button does on a convertible is operates the outside mirrors to heat them up. Of course, this is for your defrost on your windshield. And then if you want to defog and defrost, you can see that switched right there. And if you want to defog and defrost, what you're going to do is you're going to hit these buttons simultaneously for a couple of seconds to see if it'll do it for me. Let's do this. We'll go back to off. And then we're going to hit these buttons simultaneously. It wasn't working before. So with both of them working simultaneously, this is going to be the it'll defrost and defog the rear window both. I'm sorry. What that does, it activates the outside heated mirrors as well. So even me sitting here going through this, there's a lot of different functions it'll do. It's actually quite a few pages in the service manual talking about it, but it is definitely an interesting aspect of the cars. And I think I've seen quite a few videos on detailing how some of this will fail. and the buttons and the control head, because there really are not that many other components to this system. They did a really good job of lessening the amount of agony with this. There is a vacuum or operated programmer underneath here above the gas pedal. There is a blend door, temperature actuator door in there, and there's a blower module in the case under the hood. But again, I'll divide that up into another vehicle video just because I figured this would take me about 14-15 minutes to describe this system. So like I said, I want to take a moment too to thank everybody that's been watching. I appreciate the suggestions too. I'll be getting to your suggestions as soon as I can, because there is a lot of source material to work with these cars. There's a lot of intricate pieces that are used. Heck, I haven't even talked about all the functionality of this. In fact, I forgot to talk about this. I'll show you real quick. This AC controller also will go into diagnostic mode and tell you what's wrong with it. It'll even tell you if the car has low Freon. So if I go in here and I push these two buttons for 5 seconds, see that double zero popped up there? So what it's gonna do is, if there were fault codes in this, it would tell me what's wrong. It'll even actually tell me if there's low Freon in the system. So I can go through each individual system, and then it'll actually give me the parameters of what each sensor is telling the system to do. So this is an early generation of how to diagnose this equipment, but it's actually quite cool. It's a neat feature that nobody really knows, kind of a hack. In fact, the CCM, you can diagnose, you can have it run diagnostics. A couple of other systems will do the same thing. So anyway, again, thanks guys for the suggestions, comments that you've been leaving for me about videos to make. I'll be checking back in with you next week when I got some more free time. And I'll talk to you guys then. Hope everybody has a good Sunday.